This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Know-How is brought to you by CashFly.
This episode of Know-How is brought to you by DigitalOcean. Simple and fast cloud hosting built for developers. Deploy an SSD cloud server in 55 seconds. Try it today for free. Visit DigitalOcean.com, and once you sign up, be sure to enter the promo code KNOWHOW in the billing section to get your $10 credit. And by Rachio. Take control of your watering with the Rachio Smart Sprinkler Controller. It's Wi-Fi enabled to allow instant access with a mobile app and has automatic watering schedules based on the latest weather forecast to save water and money. Go to rachio.com/twit to learn more. On today's show,
you'll know how to start your Arduino project.
Welcome to Know How. It's the Twitch show where we build, bend, break, and upgrade. I'm Father Robert Ballasser.
And I'm Brian Burnett.
And for the next 30 to 45 minutes, we're going to be showing you some of the projects that we've been playing with so you can take them home and geek out on your own. Brian, it's good to see you, my friend.
Good to see you too, Padre.
Boom, pound.
Glad to be here.
That's how that works. Now, we've done a lot of Arduino projects.
Yes.
Over the last year or so. Everything from the steampunk goggles to little sensors, servo
to
controllers.
Server motors,
the PTZ thing that we just finished up. But I wanted to backtrack a little bit because some people have been complaining that we kind of gloss over the start of an Arduino project. Where do we get the inspiration for it? How do we start writing the code?
Right.
I thought it might be nice to kind of step back and show them a couple of ways that they could do something interesting without really knowing exactly what's going on.
Kind of just a getting started thing.
Yeah.
Getting the juices flowing when it comes to an Arduino project. And of course, when we're talking about Arduino projects, my favorite.
Lights!
LEDs.
The lights!
Because anything
so shiny.
That's bright and blinky, I will be immediately attracted to.
I think that's just a human thing. We like bright, we like blinky, and we like things that look shiny.
Yeah, well, the different colors don't hurt either.
No, they don't. And this is exactly what we're going to do. You will remember a while back, we were really big on WS2812 LEDs because they're individually addressable. You can change the color and the brightness of every single color inside of every single LED.
Yeah.
Very cool. But one of the things that people have been asking for is something that might be a little bit brighter, maybe run on 12 volts instead of 5 volts, and is cheaper. Because if you buy a decent set of WS2812 lights for a length like this, which is about 5 meters, you're going to pay like $80 versus this. These are RGB SMT 5050s. So they're 12-volt logic. They're very, very bright for what they are. These particular ones are waterproof, and this entire strand cost me about $17.
That's, yeah, low barrier for entry in this project.
Precisely. And, you know, if your project doesn't require individual animation of all the LEDs, I mean, if you're just looking for color, for a nice mood lighting.
Yeah, or cabinet lighting in your kitchen.
Precisely. Mm-hmm. This is actually a good way to go because, especially when you start thinking, well, I'm going to need 5, 10, 15 of these strands, the price difference between this and the 2812s, it's ridiculous. It becomes untenable.
And 12 volt, does that mean that you can then plug it into the wall if you...
Yeah, so you just need something that goes from AC 120 or 240 down into 12 volts DC. Now, the other thing about this is, unlike the WS2812 LEDs, there is no logic inside of these. So if we go to the side view here, Kara, in the 2812s, each of these individual LEDs actually had an integrated circuit that was controlling it. So I could send commands to that LED, and I could tell it, turn red, turn blue, turn a combination of green and blue, whatever it might be. And then I could also say, how bright should each color be? This will be the exact same color as that, the exact same color as that, the exact same color as that. There is no logic. All it is voltage.
Okay. Because, when we were talking about the other LEDs, you were explaining how the Arduino passes the information down to each LED, and you had to address the certain number of LEDs.
Precisely. So every light took 4 bytes.
Right.
Because there was how red, how blue, how green, and then how bright. So what you would do, if you wanted to serve 10 lights, you would make an array of 40 bytes. You would send that array down the string. The first light, the first integrated circuit that gets it, pulls 4 bytes and passes the next. And then by the time you get to the end, that's it, it's out.
And then this one is just voltage, and that determines the color and the brightness?
Precisely. There is no logic. There is no way for me to individually address the LEDs. In fact, Kara, if you go here, you'll notice these little copper traces. Those are the 4 traces I need. So I've got 12 volts, so that's positive, and then the other 3 are the ground for red, blue, and green.
So if I
connect ground plus the green lights up. If I connect ground plus the blue lights up. If I connect, power plus the ground for green, red, and blue, all 3 will light up.
Nice. Okay.
But the way that we proposed doing this a while back is I was just going to use some ESCs because I have a lot of ESCs. I had some two-phase. So what I could do is I could provide it between 0 volts and 12 volts. Right, okay. And I hooked up one up to each circuit. That works really good because it provides a lot of wattage. I can actually get 1,000 watts down that, and it will work just fine. It'll be incredibly bright. But someone in the audience, a member of our know-it-alls, Akita, actually came up with a better solution for people who are just trying to get it working rather than trying to build something that might be super expandable.
Oh, okay.
And actually, if you go to that link, Garrett, the first one. There we go. So Nico G, he sent us this. He said, look, if you want to control 12-volt LED strips, you can do it using the following. And what that is a driver module for the Arduino. This will allow you to send a command from the Arduino to this driver board, and the driver board will control how much power it's sending down each of those lines, the red, the blue, and the green.
Ah, that's pretty nifty.
Mm-hmm. And actually, go to that second link. This is the link that he actually gave us. To buy them, but you can also buy these on eBay. I bought like 5 of them for $3 a pop.
Buy them in bulk.
Yeah, they're not that expensive. They're $6. Add shipping, whatever. This one's always sold out, so I always try to go to eBay.
Mm-hmm.
But they're very, very handy if you just want to run 1, maybe 2 strings. The problem is they only can provide 72 watts, so you're not going to be really driving much more. In fact, if you try to do 2 strings, if you go full power on all colors on 2 strings, you'll notice it start to dim. It just doesn't have the wattage.
Okay.
All right. So let's go and take a look at it. This is what that module actually looks like. This is an FZ1568. Inside, it's actually really simple. Something I can get it out of the... Really? It's a Ziploc. Come on.
The hardest part of this project, getting it out of the bag.
So, really simple. This is the circuit. On this side, these two, that's where I have power in. So I have to give it 12 volts.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Yeah. On this side, this is where I'm going to hook up the 4 leads from my my LED.
Right, that makes sense.
Right, so I'm going to have, if you look in the back here, this top one, so bottom here, this is the actual 12-volt power. Then this is the ground for red, the ground for blue, and the ground for green.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
And then it's going to use these little FETs are actually letting it determine how much power to send down each rail.
Hmm, interesting.
Now what I need though is I need a way to take a signal from the Arduino and then do something with it. So it's got these 2 sets of pins. This is actually kind of ingenious. I like this because on this side is in. So this is coming in from the Arduino, the commands. And I'll show you exactly how that hooks up in just a bit.
Yeah.
But then it also has this. If I did want to control more than 1 or 2 sets of LEDs, I can actually daisy chain these modules and they'll all receive the same instructions. It'll just pass it down the line.
Oh, okay, that's cool.
Which is kind of cool. I mean, it would end up being a big wiring harness. I'm not sure if I want to do that, but...
Yeah, but the possibility is there.
The possibility is there.
Nice.
So let's go ahead and start looking at what we're going to need. We are going to need an Arduino, and we've got our trusty Arduino inside this 3D printed thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to be building on it, which is why I still want these.
The breadboard and the...
Yes,
the knobs.
You shall see. You shall see what it is for.
Such a sinister project.
Yeah, we need the driver. So this is our little 12-volt driver.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to need a string of 50-50 RGB LEDs. Again, we'll have the links for this inside the show notes. But this is about, actually, I think I bought this one for $14. If you wait for them to come on sale, there's always a sale. So I'm running, and with the Arduino, I'm running at like $22.
Not bad.
Not bad at all. I will also need a power source. In this case, I'm just going to use a battery, a quadcopter battery, because I have a lot of those.
Right.
And then I need this lead. But I wouldn't have to do this. If I just had a 12-volt adapter, I could plug it straight into here. I can just wire it in.
And then no problem. Yeah.
And then no problem. And it's actually really easy to assemble. They've made this process super, super simple. All you're going to need is a flat screwdriver, which I'm going to get from this handy-dandy little iFixit kit. And then you want to loosen these screws here, and they will allow you to insert the wires that you need and then tighten them down.
Okay, neat.
All right, so let's start off with the power, because this is the super simplest one. So we're going to loosen up these screws, like so. I'll explain it again later on, but be careful with this, because this isn't the highest quality.
Mm.
And if you twist them too much, they just tend to pop off.
So be careful. If you over-tighten it?
Yeah, don't over-tighten. So I know that because it's got silk screening, I know that this one is ground, this pin is ground, and that pin is 12 volts. So black is going to go on the inside, and positive is going to go on the outside.
Okay.
All right, cool. So it's going to look like this. Boop, 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 boop. Oop. There we go. And there we go. If you are going to do this in a permanent installation, what I would suggest is do not count on the holding force of the block.
Mm.
So have like something that's 3D printed that actually holds the cables in.
Right.
Because even if you tighten this down, if you tug hard enough, it'll pull it right out. Yeah. So just go and tighten this down. And this just guarantees that you've got a connection. Mm-hmm. Now, something else about using these blocks, I know because it's so easy, there is a temptation just to strip the wires and just shove them in there.
Yeah.
Don't do that. go ahead and take the time to tin them.
Oh, okay.
Because what you don't want is as you're inserting it into the block, you don't want like stray strands.
Oh, yes. Yeah, splay out
because they will touch something eventually.
And then zap.
So yeah, solder them so that you have a nice solid chunk going into the block.
Okay.
And so this will give me my power. And on this side, I need to take the four leads from my LED strip and put it into the driver. There's a couple of different ways I can do that. The first way is just cut it. So I could take this, cut, and strip. So if I strip these wires, I can just insert them into the block, mm-hmm. like just like that, right?
Yep, right.
And that would work if the insulation is permanent. However, I've got a slightly different way of doing it, because what I did was I cut off this. There's a connector on the edge of each of these cables.
Right.
It looks like this. So this is the connecting cable. And again, anything you buy on Amazon is going to have that. I just cut, and it's double-ended. They do one on each side so that you can daisy chain these things together.
Right.
So I cut this one off, and then I use the connector to do this. This allows me to have something that's much more flexible. So now I can just plug in the string that I want.
Right, right. So if it burns out or something goes wrong with it, you can switch it out with another one. Nice.
Again, not super hard to unscrew and replace, but anytime I can use a quick connector, I like quick connectors.
That's smart.
I'm silly like that. All right, now all we need four cables because we have to connect this driver to the Arduino board. And I've stripped this from this long set of jumpers. And you're going to see ground on this side, ground, and then voltage, VCC.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to give it 5 volts, and then this one, the gray one, mm-hmm. this is going to be my digital data pin.
Ah, the one that will be sending information from the Arduino.
Right, and this is the clock pin. And that we can use that. We're not going to use it immediately, but it actually comes in handy later on when we want to do cool effects and stuff.
Okay,
all right.
Cool.
So let's take a look. Just like before, remember, if you look at your Arduino, there are pins along this side. So let's, assuming that the connector is up top. So I'm using an Uno here. Between these two blocks, these four are all power.
Okay.
So the two middle ones are ground. Those are ground pins. Mm-hmm. And the bottom pin here and the top pin there, that's providing 5 volts.
Right.
Now, it's supposed to be for voltage to come in.
Oh, and then pass it along?
Well, it's supposed to, like, so if I'm powering the Arduino, those are the pins I powered from.
Oh, I see.
But you can also use it to pull voltage out,
which
is what I'm going to do. So I'm going to connect my ground right here and my voltage in at the bottom. Get in there. There we go.
Boom.
So that will give the driver voltage. So my ground pin and my voltage pin.
Okay.
Okay, so that's going to, I'm going to supply power to this Arduino through the USB port.
Right.
Because I need to program it. Mm-hmm. And then it's going to go from these voltage pins into the driver board, which will supply power for this.
Right.
Now, if I didn't want to do it that way, I could use like one of those UBECs to provide power. I could actually split power and give power both to the Arduino and to the driver board.
Right.
But I'm being lazy right now, so.
I mean, is there any downside to powering it through the Arduino?
If as the application gets bigger, there's more chance for you to introduce noise into the system, which you kind of want to avoid. For such a small project and a simple project that's not really timing reliant, this should work just fine.
Cool.
All right. So the next thing I want to do is these. These are going to be my data pins. And I need to know where those data pins are going to come from. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my IDE, and I'm going to explain how we're going to be driving this thing. Because you can't just go into Arduino and say, hey, turn on the driver board. You need a library.
Yep. Okay.
Thankfully, we have a library. Kara, if you go to my my laptop, this is, there we go. This is something that I just downloaded off of the same page that I bought it from eBay.
They have a library listed on the eBay page?
Yeah, they just created a library. This is something that we're going to put in the show notes, so you don't have to copy it down off of the screen. There will be a link where you can download exactly what you see here. Now, this contains both the schematics. So if you ever wanted to know exactly how this thing is connected, they give you exactly how it's connected. So I can see these are the connections that it requires in order for it to work. Mm-hmm. Over here, this is how the power works. See how I've got a single hot rail, 12-volt hot rail, and I've got the three grounds. Over here, it shows you the data in and the data out. So I can take data in, and then I can push it back out in case I want to drive another board.
Right.
And over here, this is just my power. So this is what a schematic looks like. It's not super important that you memorize it, but it's good to know how to read a schematic just so you know where things connect the first time.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, because what you don't want is you don't want trial and error and then blue smoke.
No.
That's a bad thing.
That'd be disappointing.
All right, so let's go ahead and go back here. The other thing that it gives me is this. This is a zip file that contains a custom library that it's created for me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into Arduino, into the sketch environment. And this has the previous Stepduino project that we were working on. But we want to import the library. So we're going to include a library from the zip file. And we're going to tell it where it is. In this case, it's right inside there. And it's this zip file. And there we go. Now, I've already imported it, so it's already in there. But that's how, so when our wonderful listeners and viewers download this zip file, just go ahead and tell Arduino where the zip file is, and it will add the library. Now it means that I can use all the code that will drive this board.
And you don't even need to unzip the file. The IDE just
does it for you. All right, now this, and the real reason why we did this is because it's going to give us sample code. Sample code is some of the best places to start. Because every time I get a new library, every time I get a new module, I have the ability to use code that I know works.
Right.
Which is important. Even if I'm going to write my own custom thing, at least verify that the hardware and the software is working properly.
Okay.
So I'm going to go to File. I'm going to go open Examples. And every time you add a library, if it's done properly, it's going to add examples for that library. So I'm going to scroll down until I see LED strip driver. And it gives me two. It gives me dual LED strips or single LED strip. I'm running a single, so I just open that up.
Cool.
So this is code that they wrote, and it should work. I'm going to push this into my Arduino, but the reason why I opened this up is because I need some information from here, specifically this. Notice define clock 3, define DIO 2. So it's telling me the data pin is pin number 2. The clock pin is pin number 3.
And that's what you're going to plug into the Arduino.
Right. Now, if I wanted to, I could change that. If I want the data pin to be 7 and the clock pin to be 8, great. But at least I know where to start.
Right.
All right. So let's go ahead and push this software to the Arduino. Yay, got my little doo-doo-doo. All right. And it's good. So just like before, I'm going to go ahead and upload. It's going to run through the sketch, make sure that all the code is right, and now it's going to upload it. So it's pushing it over to the Arduino, and done. Very small program.
Right.
There's not much in here. there, actually, we'll go over it later on. I want to show you what it looks like now first. Let's go ahead and hook up the hardware. So I've got my data pin on 2, like that. And my clock pin is on 3. So that's digital pin 2, because remember, I go 0, 1, 2, 3. So digital pin 2 is where the data is going.
Right.
And digital pin 3 is where the clock is going.
Right.
All right, let's go ahead and hook this up to my strip. And because we use this quick connector, it's so simple. I just do that. Now, if you are going to use these eBay specials, here's a quick hint. Oh, hold on, if I can get this connected.
Such a quick connector.
There we go.
There we go.
Quick hint. You can kind of see it. See those arrows?
Yeah.
That's telling you where to line up the voltage.
Oh, so okay.
So 12 volt goes through that top arrow. Also, just remember, you want everything on the same side. So if I did this,
will it even let you?
Yeah, it'll let me because you know it's not keyed or anything.
Oh. Okay.
But that would be bad because now I'm pushing power way to the wrong spot.
Reversed.
Yeah. So let's not do that.
Okay.
Just do it right. Okay. Now, if I did this right, I should just be able to connect power, and the Arduino should start sending signals to the driver board, and the driver board should start allowing voltage to come into the strip.
Right.
So why don't you go ahead and do that? I'm gonna.
Why do you want me to do it?
No, I think you should have the honors. I'm just going to.
Yeah, you're standing pretty far away.
I'm going to go over here.
Kind of weird. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. There we go.
There we go. Okay, so that's all it does. So what's going on is it's just sending commands to the driver board saying go full power, full voltage, full brightness on the 3 primary colors plus all the colors combined, which gives us white, plus off.
That is so cool.
So it's cycling through 5 different patterns right now.
Right.
All red, all green, all blue, all white, and then off.
Right. And then we can modify that in the software to our...
Precisely. And let's take a look at the software so you can see exactly how simple this is. This is actually even more simple than what we were doing with FastLED, the library that we use for WS2812s. So I've got all the standard definitions up here. This is the entire program. This is how it works. Driver begin, driver set color, and that's red, green, blue. So this first line is 100% red, 0% blue, green, 0% blue. Driver end.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's all I have to do.
Wow.
Driver begin opens up the field. Mm-hmm. Then I set the field. I set the color I want. And driver end shoots that out to the driver. It says, okay, go ahead and send this.
Okay. So, and that's why it's cycling through the different colors.
That's why it's cycling. Because if you look down the code, all it does is it goes driver begin, driver end, and it goes through the different colors. So I have full red, full green, full blue, and then yellow, which is a combination of red and green.
Mm-hmm.
And then cyan, which is a combination of green and blue. Then magenta, which is a combination of red and blue.
Right.
And then white, which is 100% on all colors. And then off.
And then is the brightness set somewhere in there?
Well, this is the brightness. So 100% means 100% brightness. Send as much voltage as you have available to you down the line.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, here's the fun part. Right now, we've created sort of this is a static display, right? This is just a bunch of LEDs that are displaying this kind of color.
Yeah.
But we're going to be able to control the entire strand just like we control the WS2812s. Now, I can't do individual LEDs.
Right.
But like, for example, in your place, mm-hmm. where you wanted sort of just under-the-counter lighting,
yeah.
This is perfect. You could buy $50 worth of LEDs, and they self-tack, so they just put them underneath. And then I can
use the little knobs for brightness and
precisely.
Color.
Precisely. Yeah. Why not have one knob for every color? One for red, one for blue, one for green. Yeah. And then I just adjust what I want.
Mm-hmm. Totally. Right? That's exactly what I want.
There we go. And it would be so even more simple
than what the other project we
than
did.
WS2812. Because in WS2812, you create the array, mm-hmm. then you fill the array, then you set brightness of the array, then you send the array down the line.
Right.
This... You open the circuit, you send the value, you close the circuit.
Right. And for like a long line, I don't need the ability to change each and every LED. Like the whole strand lit up is fine for me. But there is one thing I'd like to add, is like a rave button or something. you push the button and then it does all the colors and it blinks really fast and stuff. You could do that, right?
It would be cool. I guess. That's cool. Yeah. Now, actually, the real reason why I'm doing this now is because I'm creating grow lights for the little gardening projects that we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And it is so much cheaper and so much better to use these waterproofed 5050s rather than the 2812s.
Right.
2812s, they're 5 volt versus 12 volt. These are going to put out more light. These are going to be a bit more efficient with the power that I give them. They're dumb circuits, so that there's very little that can go wrong.
Right.
As long as I'm providing it power, it's going to light up.
And then you can set it on a timer through the program, right? And they'll light up at certain times or go change colors and
Precisely.
Stuff.
Precisely. Nice. Something else I should mention about these 5050s is LEDs do have a polarity. So you have to provide ground on the ground side. You have to provide power on the power side. But these strips will work from either end. There is no polarity as far as the ends are concerned. All it cares about is that there's voltage on that rail.
Right.
So for example, I can hook up, where'd my adapter go? I can hook up this side and it should work. And remember, line up the arrows.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So like so. There we go. That works just fine.
Nice.
And if I hook it up the other way around.
Shouldn't be a problem. As long as the wires are correctly lined up.
I hope they are. There we go. Other side works just fine. So don't worry about polarity on this. In fact, and we'd mentioned this before, I have done projects where I supply power through both sides. It's not good, but if I have a major power sag halfway through the line, mm-hmm. if I provide power from the other side, it'll pick it up.
It'll push through.
Yeah.
How many LEDs did you have in that? A lot?
It was a Christmas display.
Okay.
And now we've got people in the chat room who are saying, well, why are we recreating Christmas lights? Well, we have far more control over this.
Right.
Because right now we're just showing you a static example that came with the code, mm-hmm. but we're not going to stay with that. In fact, the reason why I'm not showing you how to use the wipers right now is because I want you to do that. If you think you're all that, and if you think you've got a much better use for this, if you think that you are a master of Arduino programming, or even if you're a fun amateur and you can figure it out, take the code that we use to set the WS2812 lights, because we had a separate function that all it did was take the input from the wipers.
Mm-hmm.
You will be able to use that exact same code in this to set the colors of the LED strip.
Challenge accepted.
Challenge. Do it. Do it now. All right, Brian, well, we're going to continue with our little fun jaunt through the Arduino playland. We've got a couple of surprises coming up for our audience. First, I wanted to take a step back to Maker, because if you've looked through our Google Plus group, there are some guys in there who have created some phenomenal projects.
Oh, have they?
Yes,
what
they
about
have.
Our projects?
Their projects are much better.
Oh.
And I honestly don't care about what we create, but I love what they do. Mm-hmm. We're going to show you a vendor that's going to help you turn your project, your little fun gadget, into something that's actually marketable.
Oh, I like that idea.
I do. And then we're also going to show you a new device. It's something that was just sent to us. I've been playing around with it. That's an Arduino. Think of it as an Arduino, but with Legos.
A
Leguino.
Arduino.
Linguini. A Linguini. But before we talk about Linguini, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the first sponsor of this episode of Know How. Now, folks, you know, one of the things that we've recognized is that you need a presence on the internet. Even the Catholic Church recognizes that if you're not on the internet to this generation, you don't exist. Now, how do you get onto the internet? How do you get that presence? How do you put your portfolio, your website, your blog, your next big app, your next big service online? Well, the old way to do it would be to build up a data center. Find yourself some space where you could put some machines that you've bought with software that you configured. You hire someone to make sure that it's maintained, and then you contract for things like broadband and financial transactions. Yeah, you could do it that way. That's the good old-fashioned way to do it, which, fortunately, we don't have to do anymore. We don't have to do it because we've got DigitalOcean. Now, DigitalOcean is a different way to think about being online. You don't build up a server. You don't build up hardware. You don't worry about the software. You don't hire a maintenance person. Instead, you create what they call a droplet. It's a container, a way to put everything you need for that website, that portfolio, that server, that next great app, into a self-contained piece of software that can run off of the entire DigitalOcean infrastructure. Now, it's used by over 600,000 developers, including Twit's Randall Schwartz, Aaron Newcomb, and of course, myself. It lets you deploy and configure your droplets via a streamlined control panel or a simple API, and you get to choose your OS. This is so important because it means that you can bring the OS that you like rather than having to use the one that's packaged into the plan. Ubuntu, CentOS, Debian, Fedora, CoreOS, FreeBSD, you take your pick. You could also select from one of the many pre-configured one-click installs like Drupal, Docker, Node.js, which will get you up and running quickly, or because they give you root access to 100% SSD state-of-the-art data centers, you could build your infrastructure exactly the way you want. It's highly scalable. You can start with just a small image, a small presence on the internet with one CPU and maybe one SSD array, and then grow it into a service that spans the globe on thousands of CPUs and tens of thousands of SSDs. They've got an extremely active community with a large and detailed set of tutorials on every topic, and these are people who keep coming back because they're fans of the service. If they love it, I think you will too. All their servers come with 1 gigabit per second network interfaces, and the plans start with 1 terabyte of transfer a month, and they increase incrementally. And with team accounts, you'll be able to share your account's resources without sharing login or billing information. Think about that for a second. The ability to tell someone that, yeah, they can have a little bit of a space on your infrastructure, but you don't have to share root credentials. You don't have to put them into a situation where they might do something that takes down the rest of your internet presence. It's so easy to get started, you can deploy an SSD cloud server in as little as 55 seconds. Why wouldn't you use DigitalOcean? Now, let me give you another reason why you'd want to use it, because they're going to make it free. DigitalOcean has incredibly affordable and straightforward pricing, with servers starting at just $5 per month, and there's also hourly pricing available, starting at less than a penny per hour. But we're going to make it so that you can get started today and deploy an SSD cloud server for free. Just visit DigitalOcean.com and create an account. Once you confirm your email and account information, go to the billing section and enter the promo code KNOWHOW for a free $10 credit. That's plenty to get started, and explore what DigitalOcean can do for you. Again, that's DigitalOcean.com, DigitalOcean.com. And once you sign up, enter the code KNOWHOW in the billing section to get your $10 credit for free. DigitalOcean, a better web awaits, and we thank them for their support of KNOWHOW. Hey, Brian.
What's up?
You know what I want to do?
What?
I want to make my project pretty.
Pretty? Yeah, we kind of have issues with that, right?
We do. I mean, aside from the goggles, which were kind of cleaned up, everything else has been sort of, well, there's wires.
Right. It functions, and that's what we were going for.
Exactly. Yeah. And unfortunately, that's where most tinkerers will stop. They're like, well, it works. Just don't move that and don't touch that.
Right.
And definitely don't pull on these.
Yeah.
We don't want that. We want something that's a bit more professional. Especially in this new economy where a little tinkering idea can be the next billion-dollar business, maybe we need a little help turning our tinkering project into an actual product.
I feel like you're going to show me something.
I am. Hmm. We're going to take a gander back to the last Maker Faire and look at a company that wants to make your project professional. If you're a maker, you've probably been playing around with the Arduino, maybe an Arduino Uno, maybe a Leonardo, something that allows you to fast prototype your ideas into something that does something. That's the whole spirit of Maker. But what happens when you want to move that idea past that fast prototype stage into something that you could actually ship and support? Well, that's why we're at Zimbit talking about this. Now, this is, well, what is it?
Right, so this is a platform that allows makers and people who have maker projects to turn an idea that has one or two into 5 or 10 or 50. You build one, that's great. You build two, that's great. But what happens if you want to build 50? That gets very difficult. So Zimbit solves that problem. Zimbit solves that problem by providing a motherboard, case, user interface, and also cloud services to go along with that to take care of device deployment, device management, remote debugging, and all these other features. So that makers can very quickly turn their bag of bits with bunches of wires that are sticking out and going everywhere into something that is professional, good-looking, spouse-approved, girlfriend-approved, boss-approved.
This is something that's important. We've talked about this on our show before, which is taking something that may work into something that actually looks good. It's something that I can package. It's something that I could ship to a friend or ship 1,000 to sale. Now,
what have you done with your platform? What's the special sauce, the unique features that you think will take someone who's looking at doing a fast prototype into doing fast production?
That's right. So today we have three products. That we have Zimbit Orange, which is a motherboard with an Arduino Zero compatible capability on it. It's an Arduino Zero compatible CPU. We take care of the power supplies. There's a supervisor CPU on it that takes care of everything, bringing it together, working with different voltages, making sure all the boards are powered up, powered down. In addition to it, we have security. There's also another product, Zimbit Iris, which is this touch-sensitive cover with multiple displays. This is open user programmable. They could do whatever they want with it. It has touch, and it also has security in it as well. And then there are cloud services, as I've mentioned, that take care of managing these things. And what we do is we bring it all together. So this is the difficult part. It's the 95% that nobody wants to do. It's the stuff that takes a lot of money, it takes a lot of time, takes maybe tens, maybe hundreds of thousands of dollars to get it out there. And with this, you can do it in weeks, not in months or years.
Now, if they wanted to find out more about what you can do for their products, for their prototypes, for their projects, where can they go?
Right. So first of all, they can go to zimbit.com. We also have a competition running for best designs, for best ideas that we will support, and we will give away free Zimbit hardware. So please go and sign up. Also Twitter at Zimbit. Please sign up. We will be announcing more exciting features.
Alex, thank you very much for speaking with us. And thank you for showing off the next step for makers. Now, if your prototype still has wires hanging off the side, if it looks like it was thrown together with a Lego kit, maybe you need some Zimbit.
Oh, what I really like about Zimbit is the fact that they're not trying to change the way that you tinker. They're just trying to sort of clean it up a little bit. I actually had a prototype that went through Zimbit for a little humidity, temperature, light controller.
Yeah.
And it was actually really cool. I really enjoyed the libraries and the tools that they gave me. So if you've got a project that you think might make it big time, that's probably a good place to start.
Yeah, and I think, you know the Nintendo Pi project
they
did? Oh
yeah, of course.
That went through a lot of different refinements of cable management and something. Mm-hmm. And there's definitely a satisfaction of when it looks good and it functions, so. Yeah. I can appreciate that.
Yeah. Now, when we come back, we're going to go ahead and show you a little something that I picked up that will make Arduino development even easier. If you like assembling Legos and if you like assembling blocks of code, then you're going to love the mCookie.
That's
before
me.
We get to the mCookie, you know what I'm going to do?
What's that?
I want to keep things alive.
Oh, yeah. That's easier said than done.
Well, specifically, I want to keep my plants alive. I'm not good at that at all.
Neither am I.
One of the things that I have really run into recently is because I've been growing crops inside my little grow tents for the upcoming grow how, the
right.
Green geek thing that we're going to be doing,
geeky.
Right?
The green geeky, yeah.
Unfortunately, I'm away a lot.
You're a what?
I'm away.
Oh, away a lot.
Yeah, you what did you think?
I thought you said you weigh a lot.
I weigh a lot. Unfortunately, I weigh a lot.
I'm sorry.
And that really hurts the crops because they're like, damn,
what does that have
you
to
fat.
Do?
And, you know, and my
you're crushing us.
My crops are bad-mouthing me. I'm like, oh, man. Hey, bro, come on, it's glandular. And they're like, no.
What if there was a way to control it remotely? You know?
That's what I want. I want a way to make sure that even when I'm not there, that my plants are getting watered, which is why we're so happy to have Ratio as a supporter of know-how. Now, Ratio is quite simply, it's a smart controller for your gardening. If you've got sprinklers set up, you probably have some sort of controller that you set manually, right? Maybe even has a digital control panel that you've set on the menu system.
Yeah.
Which would be great if we were still living in 1990, but we're not. We're past the 2000s. We're into the new generation where everything must be smart, which is why the Ratio can be controlled by your smartphone. Now, Brian, if you'd go ahead and do me the Vanna White honors, show
pleasure.
Me what's inside this box, because it's actually quite impressive. Inside here, you will find something that looks like a standard controller.
Ooh,
if you go ahead and go to the overhead there, you can see it.
I recognize that.
Exactly. This is where you would put in all the leads for all the different sprinkler solenoids so that it can turn on the valves whenever it needs to be watered.
Hmm.
And this looks just like one of those controllers that you would get on a traditional watering controller, right? You set your menu, and then this will show you, it's set up to go on between 4 o'clock and 12 o'clock.
It's like a regular timer.
A regular timer. But where this differs
is that this can connect to your phone. This smart sprinkler controller lets you control your home irrigation at any time from anywhere. You simply swap out your current controller with this Rachio smart sprinkler controller, you connect it to your Wi-Fi, and then you can adjust depending on the weather. It's easy to set up using either iOS or Android. It connects with popular smart home platforms like Nest, Amazon Alexa, Nexia Control 4, iControl, and more. I mean, imagine saying, and I know I'm gonna trigger some Alexas here, hey Alexa, turn off the sprinklers, and boom, you're done. That's the kind of smarts you get with Rachio. You can also run the zones directly from the controller, giving you or your landscape professional manual access. And those LED lights give you a visual indication of what's happening right now. You can also customize your watering to your yard's needs by plant types, soil types, sun exposure, and more. This is really where I think the smartness comes into it. It's not just, I want to turn on the sprinklers for 4 hours. It's, hey, you know what? Help me out, Rachio. I'm feeding lavender. What kind of watering schedule should I use for lavender? And right. It can actually suggest it to you. With Rachio's weather intelligence, it will automatically adjust your schedules for weather events that are coming in. So you don't have to worry about turning them off. You don't have to worry about manually overriding. You'll even get alerts whenever Rachio steps in to adjust schedules for rain. Now, Rachio is EPA WaterSafe WaterSense certified and tested to the industry's highest standards. It saves up to 50% on your outdoor watering bill while helping to save over 1 billion gallons of water nationwide. Check with your local water provider for rebates of up to 100% for the cost of a Rachio controller. They understand that this can save them water, which is going to save you money. Enjoy your great yard without wasting water or money. Over 1 billion gallons of water saved and counting. Now, here's what we want you to do. We want you to go to rachio.com/twit to learn more about the Rachio Smart Sprinkler Controller and to find out if you're eligible to receive a rebate from your water provider. Again, change the way you water with Rachio at rachio.com/twit. That's Rachio, rachio.com/twit. Give your plants what they need. Smart watering with Rachio. And we thank Rachio for their support of Know How. All right, Brian.
What?
Time for a little unboxing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I got this. Completely just showed up one day.
Just appeared on your desk.
Just appeared on my desk.
Like most cookies that find their way there.
And when I first got this, I'm like, oh, cookies!
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Which, because, you know, my plants think I'm fat.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're just compacting the soil, right?
They're like, we can't breathe! You're sucking in all the light. You've got the density of a black hole.
Just means you've got a lot of gravity, Padre. Oh.
Okay, no, let's actually look what's inside the box. So inside here is quite possibly one of the easiest development kits I've ever seen. It reminds me a lot of, do you remember Little Bits? They used to be a sponsor here on Twit. This is Little Bits, but with an Arduino.
Oh, okay.
And it's the same concept. Make really easy to use, easy to understand modules that I can snap together and then create projects.
Well, the colors even remind me of this little guy here.
There's a reason for that. Because if you look on the side here, this is actually Lego compatible. So if you wanted to build this into a Lego model, you could.
What?
See, there's a little Doctor Who on top. Woohoo! My favorite Doctor.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Oh, but so this is how it works. These are all magnetic. So the top level modules are all magnetic, and it allows me to say, okay, what I'm going to need for this project, I'm going to need this, of course, because this is my core CPU. This has got the Microduino, the Atmega controller. So this is actually an 8-bit dev board with an Atmega, I think it's an A32U4.
Whoa, what's the other side look like?
Oh, just like that. So, I mean, you'll notice this. This looks like one of those little smaller Arduinos that we play with.
Oh, that's awesome.
But it's also got these pins. And what those pins do is it allows them to connect to modules that are above and below. So it's got pads on this side. And pins on that side.
That is awesome.
Yeah, it's actually very well designed.
And then the other one's a Bluetooth module?
Yeah, so I've got a Bluetooth module in case I wanted to add wireless connectivity. So let's say I want to control a project via my smartphone. Yeah. I didn't have to worry about wiring up a Bluetooth module. I just snap it on. This one is the battery module. So this allows me to get power to my project even when I'm not connected to the USB. And this last one, this actually is huge. This is important. This is a hub, so it's I squared C, which is what we're going to start using on a lot of our Arduino projects because it allows us to do one wire control.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, think about the projects that we've had recently, like, for example, the servo controllers or the stepper motor controllers,
right,
where we could only hook up three before we ran out of pins.
Well, with I2C and I2C compatible drivers, I could have one cable that just goes from one I2C to the next I2C, the next. I could control as many controllers as that processor will let me do.
That is neat. I like that.
And here's how it connects. So I'm going to start with the battery module, like so. And I'm just going to put the core on top of it. And I'm going to go ahead and put this on top of that. You cannot connect it wrong. If you try to hook it up the wrong way,
the magnets won't let you.
Yeah, see, that's simple magnetism. Ah. It's like, no, hook me up the right way.
That's cool. Although now it's like, I wish I had a big computer that could do this. You know?
Right?
I just want to put a different video card in. I'll snap it in.
Exactly. Well, and then, of course, we always have to add the Lego. Hey, Patrick, I'm sorry. But,
see, this is how you know Patrick's on vacation, because we've raided his Lego stash.
Okay, but those are the main modules. There's actually more in here. Inside, of course, you're going to find, this is important. If you've bought this for a younger adult, this actually has projects where they just like match up the pictures.
Oh, okay, so you're speaking for me.
When I get you a version of this. But then I'm also going to get a lot of additional modules. This is all the power stuff. So it's going to allow me to. These are my I2C connectors, which will allow me to connect as many devices as I want to this hub. Then this is the power module, which will allow me to power either off of AAA standard batteries at 1.5 volt, or I can use lithium ion cells at 3.7 volts.
Nice.
Which is nice. It gives me a little bit of flexibility. And it means that I don't have to jury rig some sort of power solution.
Yeah, and I mean, we were just talking about making your projects look nice.
This looks
really,
really nice.
Well packaged. Yeah.
Got my little batteries in here. But this is what's important. These are the I2C devices that come into the box. So if you go to the close-up on the site here, these are two crash switches. And quite simply, all a crash switch is it's a switch that turns on when you crash into it. So this has a little toggle.
Oh.
So when you hit that, I think you can hear it.
I can hear a little bit of clicking.
Yeah, clicking. So that's off, that's on, off, on,
They're
off,
They're called
on.
What?
Crash switches.
Crash switches. Yeah.
But you'll notice, see that little port right there? That's I2C, so it's a single cable that allows me to come out rather than hooking up multiple jumpers. Okay. The other ones in here, now you'll know what these are. I get two of these.
Those look very familiar. Those look like little LEDs.
Yes, they are. These are WS2812s. And you'll notice they call them micro Arduino color LEDs, but I could actually hook up the standard WS2812 strips that I've had. It uses the same logic. Sure. This is cool. Behind here, you'll notice it has the I2C sockets, but it has out and in. So
I can daisy chain them?
I can daisy chain these.
Cool.
Because remember, the way that WS2812s work is they take the four bytes off the top of the stack.
And they just push them to the next.
Right, so it'll take it in, it'll take four bytes off of whatever comes in, and it'll push the rest through the out. And then I've got a couple of fun ones. Let's do this. I should just take this out. This is a buzzer, in case I want to make sound. And then this one right here, that's a microphone. And I'm going to be using that in a future project, because imagine a device that only responds once it gets over a certain sound level.
Oh, like lights come on to tell you to say, be quiet.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, this could replace the Burke light. Once we get over a certain amount of sound in the studio, it turns on the shut-up light.
Robots are taking over our jobs.
All right. I have preloaded some code onto this. It is just the sketch environment, but they actually provide a link to download a version of the Arduino Sketch IDE that already has the libraries built into it.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I've gone ahead and assembled. I've pre-programmed this. I'm going to need these three modules. I'm going to need power. I'm going to need the core. I'm going to need a light. I'm going to need a crash switch, which I have out. And then I'm also going to need the buzzer. So technically I don't need power, but I'm going to go ahead and hook it up. So let's start by doing this. I'm going to give this power. Thanks, you.
And everything's really well spelled out on the
super,
boards.
Super well labeled. Yeah, I mean, you can't actually plug the connectors into the wrong place, which I like. It really cuts down on the possibilities of blue smoke, because you know I don't like me blue smoke.
Yeah, we see it far too often.
Yeah, again, it's kind of sad. All right, so I'm going to hook up the battery to my power module, and this will allow me to supply power both to the core USB processor and to all the connected devices. I'm going to need some I2C cables here.
so that I can connect the individual sensors, the lights, and the switch to my project. If you go ahead, you can't plug this in wrong. Go ahead and try to connect this cable.
Watch me find a
there
way.
There we go. Connect those two.
Connect these two.
Yeah, so put those I squared C cables into there.
Okay.
But you got to do it here so Kara can get you.
Oh, geez.
I know, right? It's so demanding.
Let's see. I got to put it in there.
I can't see it, Brian. Come on.
A little higher.
Now, while you're working on that, I'm going to go ahead and start assembling the rest of the project. You can, there's a forward and a backward, but it won't plug in backward. Oh, wait, no. So you need a separate cable for that.
What?
There you go.
All right.
There we go.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Now you're getting it,
Brian. It's all coming together now.
It's all coming together. All right. So we're going to go from the power. We're going to drop the core USB on top. Mm-hmm. We're going to drop the hub on top of that.
Right.
Now we need to connect this to here. I have predefined ports. So if you look at, I don't know if you can see on the sides here, there's actually numbers that run on the sides of each of these, and it tells you what devices are associated with those particular pins.
Yes, I can read those. There are, in fact, numbers there.
Yeah.
Just really itty-bitty.
Really teeny tiny. And this is where the instruction book is going to come in, because when your young adult, or when you go to assemble the project, hold on, let's this. I think this one was the birthday. Yeah, the birthday project.
You say you programmed it. How did you interface with it?
It's just USB. There's a little USB port right here.
Oh, okay.
So it connects just like an Arduino, just like any other Arduino that you've known. It connects to the USB port. It's seen as a serial port, and then it allows you to do it. So here, this shows you the...
Sorry. Got distracted.
This shows you the circuitry. So up top, so 6-7 is going to go to the buzzer.
You should point that towards the camera.
6-7 is going to go to the buzzer. 4-5 is going to go to the crash switch.
Ah.
And then down here at the bottom, I'm going to have A0 and A1 go to the LED.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So let's go ahead and hook this up. LED, where are you, LED? There we are.
Oh.
That's going to go to the bottom. Like so.
Bottom right corner, right?
Buzzer is going to go up top. Like so. And then I've got the crash switch, which goes into the slot right below it, like so.
It's just like Legos.
Just like Legos. And then I'm going to go ahead and give it some power.
Okay.
And once I confirm that
blue
it has
smoke.
Power, oh, actually, I think the batteries are dead.
Oh, no.
Yeah, so folks, whenever you do a demo like this, always make sure the batteries are okay.
Do you want me to go get some batteries?
No, I'm going to just power it off the USB.
All right.
Yeah. That's what we're going to do. Sorry about that.
I may
have had a bit too much fun with this last night. Sorry about that. That's my fault. There we go. And there we go. Now we got power.
Boop, boop, doop, doop.
Give it time. It's going to go ahead and boot up. It should still find the code that I pushed up to it yesterday, just like I did on a standard IDE sketch.
Oh. Happy birthday? Is it because it's alive and it's its own little birthday song for
basically.
It? Oh, that's cool.
So what we've just done is we've created one of those annoying Hallmark singing gift cards.
Yep.
which in and of itself is not a great accomplishment.
No.
But imagine, this is actually a pretty advanced Arduino project, because not only do we have to deal with the code, but we're dealing with I squared C, which is very cool.
Yeah, no, that's really cool.
And unlike some of the other kits that we've had on the show, this is, because it's an Atmega chipset, because it uses the Arduino sketch environment, because it uses standard I squared C,
yeah.
I can take all of the devices that we've been playing with on the show since we started playing with Arduino, and it will work on this.
That is really cool.
There you go.
And you can just disassemble it too, right?
Yep, just pull it apart.
Done.
There you go.
And then I can snap it back, and it would start playing again.
Exactly. And it gives you the added benefit of, if you've got kids who are playing with this, they can build these devices into the middle of Lego devices. So imagine you have one of the Lego Mindstorm that actually has stepper motors built into it.
Oh.
Now get some I2C drivers and you can remote control. You can create the brain for like a Lego walking device.
Yeah, or you can put little LEDs inside of your Millennium Falcon and like light, hit a button and have it light up inside and stuff.
Yeah.
Cool.
So if you are looking for a cool kit, go ahead and try out mCookie. We're going to be doing some projects with this because I do want to expand on this. It's not the cheapest thing ever. Actually, Kara, I believe we have a link here. This is the basic building blocks kit that we have in front of us. It's $99. So could you buy it less expensively? Absolutely. In fact, you could probably put together all the things that we have on the table for about $40.
Mm-hmm. But they wouldn't be magnetic.
It wouldn't be magnetic. It wouldn't snap on like this.
Yeah.
It wouldn't have a library of ready-to-go projects.
That's true.
Which, you know, that's what you're paying for. And that's fair. It gives you something over the standard Arduino environment. And if you are one of these people who was complaining that we don't have enough projects that start you simple enough,
this is
about as simple as you can get.
You could buy this box and give it to your kid. Yeah. You wouldn't instead of like, here's an Arduino, like, go figure it out.
Exactly. Hey, so I saw someone do something really cool with this Arduino. I'm just going to throw it at you. Have fun.
See what happens. Yeah.
This actually starts them off with, here are 10 projects that you can do.
Right.
And by the time you get to the end, even though at the beginning you were just assembling blocks and then loading preloaded software or pre-created software, by the end you should have an understanding of how the individual pieces work.
Very cool. I like it.
Yeah. We're going to give you links to this kit and to everything else that we talked about in our show notes because, folks, I'm sorry, we've come to the end of this episode. Brian, where do they find our show notes?
Oh, I think if you wander on over to twit.tv/KH, you'll find not only our show notes, but handy links to subscribe or download the version of the episode that you would prefer. And so if you want the links to this project, you want that. And, you know, there's other projects that we've covered that you'll probably want show note links for that, too.
Yeah. Of course, if you really want to get engaged with the know-it-all community, you gotta join us on Google Plus. Just go to Google Plus and search for Know How. There is an approval process because we're trying to get rid of all the spammers. But once you're in, you will have access to an amazing group of over 10,000 makers, builders, DIYers, geeks, people who just like to see things being built. If you've got a question about a project, if you've got a desire for a new project, or if you're an expert who would like to come back and help those who are just starting off, please, please, please join us.
That's right. Submit your projects, and we might even feature it on the show. But if you wanted to contact us directly or you wanted to see what we're doing outside of Know How, you'd want to follow us on Twitter.
Tweet, tweet.
I am Cranky_Hippo.
And you're going to find me at PadreSJ. And you're going to find our director. Or actually, sorry, we are technical director.
Technically our director.
Kara Gumpel.
Grumpel. That's disgusting. Don't suggest.
I think it was Kara.
Actually, Kara, what is your Twitter address?
@KARA080.
And you need to follow her because right now the Twit raccoon is almost catching her. So please follow her.
And there's a big mystery behind the 080. I think there's a story behind it. Right?
Don't ask about it.
Forget about it. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballasier.
I'm Brian Burnett.
And now that you know how,
go do it. Lego it. I'm going to snap all these together.
I know, right?